Very good morning to all of you and warm greetings from All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. Let me first thank the organizers, Professor Mohti, Professor Nagler, Professor Faikon for giving this opportunity. It is a great honor to follow Professor Bard's talk and getting the opportunity in the same session. Myeloma is one disease which is increasing now gradually in India too, probably due to industrialization. And that too, you can see the reflection, particularly in the metros like Delhi, where it number gradually have been mounting up. We have always thought whether the myeloma biology is different in developing countries or resource-limited countries compared to the industrialized nations. What we did, we just compared this data from one of the major series from Mayo Clinic. We have myeloma almost 10 years younger in India compared to the what Mayo Clinic published. We have almost 12% of patients who are under 40 years of age. We have now started seeing patients who are asymptomatic, but the number is still very, very low. We have almost nearly 40% or little more patients who come with the stage 3, and almost like one third of them have the renal failure. So probably we have the patients who have the large volume of disease. Maybe they present late, diagnosed late, or referred late to our center. To study the cytogenetics, we did the karyotyping. 5% of patients did have hypodiploidy. Almost similar to the figures, nearly less than a quarter did have the face abnormality with the 17p or 414. Now, this little heterogeneity, because this data is not on the plasma cell selection, so the number may be a little lower compared to what we have been reading. The other thing which we tried to see, that the bone marrow microenvironment, is it so for this, we estimated the various cytokines, newly diagnosed patients of myeloma, those who were relapse refractory, and we measured this BGF, interleukin-6, TNF-alpha, B-cell activating factor, and RANK ligand. Also, we compared to the paired sample in 37 patients where we have the pre- and post-treatment samples, and we could demonstrate that there was a reduction in the value of some of these cytokines following the treatment. There was also suggestion whether the bone marrow plasma, if you measure these cytokines, is different compared to the serum in the peripheral blood. We did find the BGF levels were higher in the serum compared to bone marrow plasma. And also the B cell activating factor, which was higher in the serum. But in others, we did not really find the difference. We have done some work on the signaling pathway, but maybe that we will present in the one of the next meeting. So just coming to little treatment, how we have been following in our setup. We did have the availability of thalidomide as it became available in the early part of last about 10 years prior. So we decided to compare the thaldexa with the lendexa. And these are the responses which we obtained. almost close to 70% in both arms. And we did not really find difference at that time of follow-up of 3 years, between Theldexa and Lendexa, both in the overall as well as the PFS. Subsequently, when the bortezomib became available, we have done a randomized trial between the BRD versus Lendexa, and the patient characteristics were similar in both arms, and we found almost 78% versus 74% patients achieving significant response in the BRD versus RD arm. The curve seems to be a little higher for the BRD, but the follow-up is still short, less than 2 years. So we will probably have to see another 1 or 2 years later whether we get any difference between the two. Now, giving a little flavor how we have been doing the stem cell transplant at our institute, we generally have followed the standard policy for, we have been giving like 4 to 6 cycles of induction therapy. So there is some discussion recently whether we should really give beyond 4 cycles. And but obviously it takes little time. By the time you start counseling patients, discuss, they take little time to decide for transplant. So we may end up into giving another 1 or 2 cycles and then take them for transplant. So we have data till December 2016 of 349 patients of multiple myeloma who have been transplanted. And we had almost 1/3 of them did have the ISS3, and 15% of them had the either progressive disease or stable disease at the time of transplant. The policy which we have followed for mobilization of stem cells, we use the GCSF for 5 days in 2 divided doses. We do the peripheral blood CD34 count on day 4. If they are less than 20 per microliter, then we go for the Plerixafor. We generally have not been freezing stem cells, so we have been doing electively, admitting patients, doing the collection, and then following by transplant. That really saves a lot of cost to us. And this was the based on some of the work which we did as a part of prospective study. What we have seen, interestingly, over the last 12 years or so, the complete remission rate, the immunofixation negative, as we defined Professor Blade's criteria, it has gone up to 60% in our recent analysis. And partly of this is because we had the, except the first study, which we published in BMT at that point of time, we novel agents became the predominant as part of induction therapy in the subsequent study. So that may have been the one of the major reasons. And that's what we actually believe, that if you achieve a good response prior to transplant and following transplant, that is really the most vital thing for the long-term outcome. With the overall survival of 91 months at 6 years follow-up, and the PFS of little above 3 years. And if you see the table down just below this, we have now 20% patients living at 20 years with PFS of nearly 10% at 20 years time. And the CR, achievement of CR, is the most important single denominator which really stands out of these responses. And same is reflected here in these survival curves, both overall as well as the progression free. So recently we, after the some of the initial reports, we started using consolidation and we have done a prospective study. And following transplant, we the response evaluation. We give two cycles of BRD chemotherapy, BRD therapy to these patients, and then followed by response assessment and also MRD. These are some of the characteristics. And we have used the five color flow panel for this MRD assessment. And these are some of the initial results of first 41 patients which we have done. The CR rate have gone up to the nearly to the tune of almost 95%. These are the patients who practically had CR prior to transplant. And the MRD negativity rate from day plus 100, which is to be half of them, 52%, has gone up to 77%. These are some of the, so this is just about only 1 year follow-up for these patients. We really have to see. We had some mild toxicity, no really major toxicities, which we have witnessed so far. And five patients of these 41 have relapsed. Two of them had MRD positive on the day plus 100. So that's what, it's one of the predictive that these are the people who are likely to have relapse. So to conclude, consolidation with at least two cycles of BRD in our hand seems to improve the response rate and also the increase the MRD negativity post-transplant. Obviously, we have to see the long-term follow-up, how it really translates in the long-term. Initial part, we were using thalidomide in low dose, 50 milligram per day. In fact, we have been able to give the patients for a long period of time. And those we have been especially looking for the peripheral neuropathy. And beyond 2 years, we have been able to give like two times a week or three times a week, and sometime in once a week. Because patients would like to continue, they would be reluctant to stop, they feel that it may be keeping them. But in the recent years, we have lenalidomide and bortezomib, which we have been using for maintenance. So to summarize, we believe, at least in our setup, the optimum induction with best response and followed by early transplant probably leads to the good response, CR or near CR, which with following with maintenance led to the prolonged survival and cure in at least about a one-fifth of patients, at least in what we have the limited follow-ups for these patients. So I'd like to acknowledge our clinical team, people from lab, and some of the funding agency. Thank you so much.